problem is that we have two chelators. Actually, there's nothing on the FDA schedule that you could use to treat acute mercury toxicity. If you are made acute mercury toxic, it's just massive medical intervention at the hospital to try and keep you alive. We have no drugs that would help with that. The drugs that we have that are available and are used somewhat in this country, approved for lead toxicity, are two compounds called DMPS and DMSA. And they are dithiol compounds that people propose are chelators, but they're not true chelators because they have the thiol groups on adjacent carbon atoms. In other words, the thiol groups are this far apart. The mercury atom's as big as my fist, so it can't fit in between the two thiols. So you can't form two thiol bonds from one of those molecules. So what happens is you have one form with it and another on the other side in a sandwich complex. The problem with that is that the single bonds can be broken when they interact with the protein and it will stay there. And the studies that have been done have shown that if they inject rats with mercury, allow them to adjust, not enough to kill them, but then if they treat those rats with the chelators, the DMPS and DMSA, that while it does take the mercury out of the soft tissues of the body somewhat, if they keep it up long enough, it actually takes it to the kidney and it will increase the level of mercury in the kidney, and the rats suffer from renal failure, a certain level of renal failure. So these chelators have not been very effective. And they actually don't bind mercury tight enough. They don't stay in the blood long enough to get the mercury out of the body. They have very poor penetratability into the membranes. They don't cross the blood-brain barrier or get into the bone marrow very effectively, which is a lot where mercury goes to do its damage. So they're just very poor. They were invented and developed in the 1930s and 40s by the Russians and Germans with regard to the war effort, you know, to get heavy metals out of certain containers, etc. So, but there's nothing effective, and our NIH has never pushed the issue or the need for heavy metal chelators. Dr. Bill Duncan, who's a PhD in biochemistry, worked for the government, was an advisor to one of our congressmen, and wanted to, when he heard about the compound we had and what we'd seen that it prevented the rats from dying at lethal doses, wanted to introduce us to people at the NIH that could help us and see if we could find some funding or to give it to the NIH and let them do the research. The other one that's available is EDTA, which is ethylene diamine tetracetic acid. It has four acetic acid molecules. It has four negative charges on it. It doesn't get into cells very effectively either, and it doesn't bind mercury. It will not pull mercury off of a protein. It just does not have that much affinity for mercury and cadmium. It's ineffective at getting mercury out of the body. But mercury is the one molecule that when you reach a certain level, it prevents its own excretion. It's that toxic. And so then you start retaining the mercury. And the mercury level builds up in your body. It's called a retention toxicity. And this is the problem we have in the United States right now. It's a fight between conventional medicine and alternative medicine. That when people go in, they can take these compounds, this DMPS and DMSA, and they can do a mercury challenge test. They measure the amount of mercury in your urine and blood just by itself. They then put in the DMPS, and the DMPS will bind the mercury that's in the blood. It doesn't get inside cells effectively. It doesn't take it out of the brain or probably the bone marrow. But within a few hours, the mercury it does have capability of binding to in the blood will be excreted in the urine. So they look at the mercury level in the urine before the challenge and then the urine after the challenge, and it will go up. And how high it goes up is used by medical doctors to determine what's the mercury body burden, relative mercury body burden of the people who have high levels of mercury. And there are a lot of people. I just talked to a dentist here today that her mercury challenge test, she went up to 100 micrograms per gram, 110 micrograms per gram of creatinine. And she was sick. She's developing arthritis. She's having all kinds of problems. And taking the EDTA, et cetera, and doing this test over and over for many months, she saw a very low drop of the mercury that she had in her body. And to add to the end of the story, taking the compound I invented, for one period of time before her last study, it went from somewhere around 90 and 110 and 60 in those first three readings down to 14. And that's getting something, that's still elevated, but if she had kept continued taking it, she would have gotten rid of most of mercury. We have several dentists and medical doctors who have taken these studies time and time again over the years because they're afraid of their exposures. And when they take the compound we used to call OSR, after taking it for a few months, they have non-detectable levels of mercury and lead in their blood and in their urine. And so I think we've known this for some time, that it did this, and this can be because the compound is also a good antioxidant. And then what that means is it means that it raises your blood glutathione levels and the glutathione levels in all of your cells, because it does get in all your cells. And when you raise that, then you have the glutathione, which can bind the lead and the mercury and the cadmium and excrete it through a natural process. It is a very potent chelator, as well as being a very potent antioxidant, just like glutathione. Glutathione in your body protects you two ways, for sure. One is it binds to the hydroxy radicals that are generated by toxins that induce oxidative stress. And by binding to that hydroxy radical, it keeps that hydroxy radical from interacting with your DNA, RNA, proteins, etc. The second thing it does is if it gets near mercury, it will bind to mercury and it will carry that mercury out of the body. All the mercury that leaves the body of a normal, healthy person goes out as being chelated by glutathione. Glutathione is a chelator. It's a naturally produced chelator. The problem with it is it's also an antioxidant. So when you get under oxidative stress, your levels of glutathione drop, and then your ability to excrete mercury drops also. And a lot of the people, like children who are ill, that have an infection, etc., it's something else is consuming their ATP, or the body is using glutathione to fight the viral infection. That drops down, and if you give them an injection of thimerosal and a vaccine, they're much more susceptible to damage. So this compound, the compound we made, is just really a super glutathione molecule. It's super in its ability to react with hydroxy radicals, you know, scavenging them, preventing them from consuming the glutathione in your body, which is used to remove other toxic organic molecules. And it also binds to mercury that's in the body, rendering it non-toxic. And for example, we've done studies where we have injected rats with increasing lethal levels of mercury, 1 lethal level 2 to 14. And then after a half an hour after that mercury has dispersed throughout the rat's body, and in high levels, they're going into convulsions. If we inject this under the skin, the flap of the skin, subcutaneously, we've recovered almost all those rats from mercury toxicity. The next day they will be well, and they will totally recover. If it's a low level, just like 1 or 2 lethal doses, they don't even get sick. You don't see any loss of weight, etc. And when we sacrifice these animals, we've done a study, it's coming out, and measure the mercury in their organs, it's there. But there's no outward sign of toxicity. For example, in the 10 rats that were given mercury alone, 6/10 of a lethal dose, 2 of them died, all of them had blood in their urine and feces, all of them lost weight, all of them became ataxic, couldn't walk straight, and at the end of 5 days, we sacrificed them. And compared them to a group that got the same amount of mercury, and then 20 minutes or 30 minutes later, we treated them with the compound by injection under the flap of their skin. They didn't get sick at all. They didn't lose weight. None of them died. None of them had blood in their urine and feces. And when we did it was a third-party group, a university that did this research for us. When they did that and looked at the kidneys, they weren't inflamed at all. So it totally protected. Then you take all of those tissues and you analyze the level of mercury. The compound did not rapidly decrease the amount of mercury that was in the body. That mercury was still there, but it was non-toxic. And that was their conclusion, similar to what we had seen earlier with the lethal dose studies. The mercury is still in your body, but it's tied up by this compound and rendered non-toxic. Now, that mercury that's tied up was going out in the feces of these rats. I mean, but it wasn't going out any faster with or without the compound. They seemed to be at the same level. Because your body can only transport so much at a time, but it would slowly get the mercury out. We know it doesn't build up in the body because we've measured it. And we're doing further studies to confirm that even more absolutely. But the bottom line is we have something that's phenomenal. I mean, no one else can talk about anything that would prevent death from multiple lethal doses injected in under your skin of mercury chloride. And this will do that. So we have something that's going to be, we think, effective for treating anyone that has a high level of mercury, cadmium, lead, or arsenic exposure.